This is so much of what life is like for creatives who are trying to find a creative profession.
She goes into this hypomanic place of, I can do anything. I'm not the Baroness, I'm better.
Oh, indeed I am.
If anything happens to people around me, it's my fault that happened. She blames herself for her mother's death because a kid doesn't understand that it's not my fault.
She always felt weak and powerless.
Yeah.
As Estella.
That's the past. I'm Cruella.
She lays hold on the Cruella persona because that is where her power is.
But people do need a villain to believe in, so I'm happy to fit the bill.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies. This is...
Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker who needs some therapy.
And maybe a nap, but we're gonna power through this one today.
You know what's gonna wake me right the hell up?
What?
Cruella,
man.
She is so punk rock. Honestly, right up front, I have a note about the filmmaking. There are a lot of needle drops in this.
Uh-huh.
Needle drops, by the way, are like when you start a song. The needle drops are fun in this movie, but man, they should have all been punk rock songs.
And they leaned into that like that was the scene in London at the time they said it.
Yeah, totally.
The purpose of our villain therapy series, just like our Psychology of a Hero series, is to explore that both our heroes and our villains, just like us, struggle with relationships, personality struggles, mental health struggles. If you struggle with mental illness, you are 10 times more likely to be a victim of violence than a perpetrator.
Correct.
That said, there's some interesting stuff going on with this character.
Very interesting.
And let's just dive into Disney's reboot remake that posits her as a protagonist.
So I'm actually going to push back on that a little bit. What I loved about this movie is it gives us a bunch of reasons, but at the end of the movie, it doesn't really set her up as a protagonist. It is very much, oh, Cruella's a villain now.
Yeah.
Like, she is a bad person doing bad things.
This is her origin story.
But it's fun to watch.
Yeah.
And that's... Every time, you know, because, like, studios give the note all the time, is this character likable enough? No one cares.
Yeah.
You don't have to like a character as long as they're interesting to watch. And holy crap.
Is she interesting to
so
watch?
So much fun. The second half of this movie where it goes full telenovela and just bananas is so great.
This is giving us an alternative version that still kind of lands us more or less in the same ballpark of who Cruella de Vil is that we know and despise, or in this case, kind of love-hate.
Love to despise?
Yeah.
It's fun to watch.
So there's Estella and there's Cruella. There's this other side of her that her mother is teaching her, like, your nasty side, we're going to call that Cruella. I think we all have this. We have the side that's more salty, side that's more driven, the side that doesn't mind stepping on people.
Mine's named Malin.
Malin?
Mal meaning bad.
Oh my gosh, that's such a reach.
This episode is sponsored by Factor.
Factor makes it so easy for me to make and stick to my health goals. Gotta look good on camera, yo. They have over 29 meals and over 33 add-in options, and meals are updated every week, so every week I can pick my meals.
And I can let Factor pick my meals for me, so I don't even have to think about it. Food just shows up and I eat it. I just let Factor bring me a box of stuff.
It's like a bidet. No prep, planning, or mess.
It's like a bidet for your mouth.
That is not my best metaphor. I take it back. These are delicious.
Super good. What do you have?
I've got sour cream and chive chicken because I figured it's my favorite potato chip. It should be my favorite meal.
That logic tracks.
Did you get a smoothie? Chug, 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 chug.
I don't even have to think about what to eat. It's just there and ready for me and delicious.
Meals are ready in 2 minutes, which is way faster than ordering out.
I do have to mention factors now.
Rip my lip.
Oh no.
I was so rapid for the food that I didn't even consider my own personal welfare.
Do have to mention, Factor is now owned by HelloFresh.
Sounds like Disney owning Pixar.
Yep, both good, slightly different.
Mm-hmm. Now, HelloFresh is great if you want to prepare and cook a meal with somebody.
And Factor is fantastic if, like me, you don't ever want to think about what you have to prepare to eat. You just want something to show up and then you can consume it mindlessly like a monster.
Great, healthy food for monsters and for people. I've never had broccoli in a microwave meal that was any good at all.
I don't like cooked broccoli and I like this.
So whatever evil pact you made with Satan, well
thanks
done.
For making an evil pact with Satan, Factor.
Head to go.factor75.com/cinematherapy120 and use code cinematherapy120 to get $120 off.
Buy it and eat it.
There's more, right?
I just wanted to really quickly talk about something that rings very true to me. This is the scene where... she gets discovered by the Baroness.
Oh, okay.
And we're going to talk about how much luck plays a factor in anyone who wants to be a creative professional.
Well, it's talent, but then you got to be in the right place at the right time and meet the right people. And
yeah, I mean, luck is people debate, you know, is luck a real thing or is it preparation meets opportunity or whatever. Obviously, you have to be talented, but you can have all the talent in the world, and if you're never in the right place at the right time, like drunk inside a shop window.
This reminds me too much of the scene from Elf.
Why'd you go to sleep in a window?
She says, I can't leave you like that. To the mannequin.
Oh, but seriously, how much better do you look?
No! No!
Hello.
Out!
I love this guy.
I like that they have Horace and Jasper as like her pickpocket friends.
She's coming, the Baroness.
And they're buddies instead of just someone that she mistreats. I mean, she ultimately mistreats them.
She's coming! No! Hello. Is there a back way out or?
The Baroness, the fashion designer. I want to see her.
Emma Stone is going so big with all of this stuff.
That window display.
I'm so sorry. I can explain that.
This guy is amazing.
Sorry, Baroness. Get her.
His inflections and mannerisms are so unique.
Messed up the whole window display.
No.
We're dealing with it.
All right, easy, easy, easy.
So she works here?
Oh, no, no. She was fired. Yeah. We're trying to give these wretches a chance, but, breeding.
And then the snort. Breeding.
So she doesn't work here.
What's the right answer?
I'm not convinced I know.
You're sweating, and I can smell you.
Thank you.
You, grubby girl.
Yes?
Jeffrey Card.
Cold.
You're hired. This address, 5 a.m. Don't be late.
You're a fool. That girl put together a better window display than I've seen here for 10 years.
Here, here.
You were right. This is a very good shop.
Oh, God, it's all so depressing.
Horace is so great throughout. I mean, so many of the side characters do a ton of heavy lifting. This is so much of what life is like for creatives who are trying to be, like, trying to find a creative profession. You work and you work and you work and you do all these amazing things and no one notices and no one notices and no one notices. And then somehow, for some reason, you're in the right place at the right time.
And meet the right person.
And you meet the right person and you get your shot. I mean, then, you know, you have to not screw it up. Maybe don't, you know, get your boss arrested for your mother's murder.
Man, this is such a soap opera. This is a telenovela meets Devil Wears Prada, and it's super fun.
Oh, it's so great.
So
I love that you bring up Devil Wears Prada. Did you know this was written by Aline Brosh McKenna?
No,
who
but
wrote Devil Wears Prada?
I can see that. I mean, it's not even a tired rehash. It just feels inspired by. Like, it takes the ideas of Devil Wears Prada.
And just like, what if we turned all of that up to 12?
Well, and what if instead of, you know, the boss learning to be a better person, we go the opposite direction, and she gets worse and worse and worse as it goes.
So one of the big, you know, obvious filmmaking things that's happening here is wardrobe.
Mm-hmm.
None of this stuff just happened. Like, everybody, there were millions of decisions made about this.
And wardrobe in this film isn't even, like, the B-side. It is the story.
It is the story.
Yeah.
The story is there's Estella and her wardrobe, and there's Cruella and her wardrobe. And it is, these are the two different character sides, and it is very apparent.
Yeah.
Wardrobe is one of the few departments that I've never actually worked in film.
Really?
It will shock you to learn that I am not much of a fashion designer. I wear Henleys.
Billy, it's just not the right style.
Style? You're going to talk to me about style? You can't even dress yourself. Look at that bow tie.
Don't even be talking about my bow tie.
But I am blown away. Like, they did amazing work on this film. It all feels heightened but believable.
Yeah.
It feels period but modern.
Mm-hmm.
It is fantastic wardrobe work. Like, pay attention to every single thing Emma Stone wears, every single thing Emma Thompson wears.
And Emma Thompson, because she's not this exotic beauty, she usually in most films dresses very down to earth, and her makeup's very down to
earth. Sometimes dowdy, depending on the character. But yeah, right. That's generally what she plays. So putting her in this couture is
super fun.
She's obviously pretty all the time.
Yeah.
Like, even when she's playing a dowdy character, it's like, yeah, but it's Emma Thompson. She's still pretty. And this is like, damn. Hello.
Because they glammed her up. So let's keep diving in. Let's look.
She called my mom a thief. Said she failed as a mother.
What? Your mum? She knew your actual mum?
It turns out that was her party we were at. Mum worked for her once.
So at this point, she doesn't realize the Baroness is her birth mother.
Running away. She must have found it.
That revelation comes real late in the film, actually.
It's mine. So I'm taking it back.
Taking it as in?
Stealing it.
Yeah.
Ooh, ladies and gentlemen, I give you the angle.
The angle.
Because up to this point, they didn't want to steal from the Baroness. She's like, I want to go straight. I want to have a fashion career. I want to, you know.
Because she's been a petty thief this whole time. Yeah,
always with the idea that at some point she would go straight and pursue this dream.
Sure.
But the moment she realizes the Baroness is the woman responsible for my mother's death, now
I'm going to use my petty thief skills to wreak some havoc.
Yes. And here she starts to feed into, even though she's been a petty thief, she's still been Estella.
She's still been Estella, yeah.
She looks out for Horace and Jasper, treats them like equals. And we're going to start to see, so this is the villain side of things, not the mental illness side of things, where she starts to lean into the darkness a bit more.
Yeah.
Out of bitterness, out of anger, out of hatred. It's terrible for real life, but it's super fun to watch.
Super fun to watch. There's a ton of exposition and a ton of narration.
From the very beginning, I've always made a statement. Ignore them. Genius girl turns into stupid girl who gets her mother killed.
Most of it, I don't feel like needs to be there.
Yeah.
I was a little like, why do people like this movie so much? And then the second half of the film, there's almost no narration, and it gets a lot more propulsive and is so much fun that I almost forgot that the first half of the film, I was like, this is meh.
Yeah.
So it's very much like Cruella herself, a tale of two halves.
Wow. Well played, sir. Well played.
Was it?
That's terrible.
I want to focus on her as an example of something called hypomania.
So that's like less than mania? It's not hypermania.
Yes. Correct. Now, some people have posited that this is dissociative identity disorder and that she actually has two different personalities inhabiting the same body. I don't think so, and I'll tell you why. Because she can choose.
Yeah, she can switch back and forth at will.
Yeah.
This is not...
There's never a moment where, like, one kind of takes over the other. It's very much a deliberate choice. I'll delve a bit more into what hypomania is in a moment, but there's not a lot of hypomania in Estella.
Yeah, no, she seems very pretty level-headed and balanced.
In Cruella, when she's very motivated to bring down the Baroness, we start to see some of this, and I'll point it out as we go.
You know, we've all had bad things happen to us. Me, him, you. But we've always been there for each other.
That's all I'm asking. Is it so hard to back me up?
No. Not Estella, that's easy, but to help Cruella, it's a nightmare.
And there's that understatement thing you do.
Cruella gets things done. Estella does not. And I have things to do. So if you're done chatting. And by if, I mean you are.
Oh, man. This is not how she treated them growing up. She was grateful for their company, grateful for their friendship, and now she doesn't even feel remorse for it. Which I see more as a factor of her focus and drive on vengeance now than anything.
I'll allow it.
But I'll allow it. So, hypomania, if we look at bipolar, you look at manic depressed.
Yeah.
And here is your baseline. Here is just kind of normal thinking and feeling. So when you're depressed, you've got low energy, you've got low drive, you've got low motivation, you got low confidence. And in a manic phase, it's the exact opposite of that. It's the polar opposite of that, which is why they call it bipolar.
Sure. You're up at 2 in the morning, you're running around reading books, you're pissing off your parents. Watch our Silver Linings Playbook episode.
When you're manic, you've got all this energy, you've got all this drive, you've got all this ambition, you've got all this confidence. And to the point where you're damaging your relationships, or to the point where it's actually impeding the amount of work you can get done because you can't focus, right? Or you're getting a ton of work done, but you're neglecting other things, or you're not getting a lot of sleep and you don't feel the need for sleep and it's affecting your health, or you're so confident that you're not seeing the world through a realistic lens, right?
Yeah.
So here's depressed, here's baseline, here's manic, and here's hypomanic. If someone's having a manic episode, they tend to be really flighty and energetic to the point where a lot of people are like weirded out by it. Like, oh, this is, I don't know what to do with this.
This is uncomfortable.
I don't know what to do with this energy, which Silver Linings Playbook is a great example of that. You know, you see Bradley Cooper all in that state. Hypomanic tends to be more measured.
Okay.
So on the surface, it doesn't register as whoa. But under the surface, again, a lot of energy, a lot of motivation, a lot of I can do anything, I don't need sleep. And sometimes it takes the form of, and this is why I wanted to watch this clip, irritability.
Okay.
Sometimes it's really happy, but sometimes it's very irritable and very cross, especially because people that I care about are now seen as obstacles to the goals that I have, right?
Sure.
I mean. And so that's what we're seeing with her, is this type of hypomanic state. And these episodes can last for an extended period of time, days, weeks, months even.
Mm-hmm.
Another therapist might have a different opinion. My clinical opinion is that when she goes into Cruella and she's driven to bring down the Baroness, she slides into a hypomanic state and she stays there for the rest of the film. Let's consider some more of the evidence, shall we?
This is her full, like, I love this soliloquy. Also, pay attention, this shot that just started when she dropped the bike. This is a 3 minute long shot that is a big soliloquy from Emma Stone that she delivers flawlessly. There are no edits. There is nowhere to hide.
That's awesome.
So this is a confusing day.
This is the fountain where she comes to talk to her mom.
Yeah.
My nemesis is my real mother. And she killed my other mother. I guess you were always scared, weren't you, that I'd be a psycho. Like my real mom. Hmm? That explains all the tone it down, try and fit in stuff. Love me into shape, I suppose, was the plan.
So the one filmmaking issue I have with this, it's this big, long shot, does all these things. It's handheld. And it feels too, I mean, it's supposed to be kind of shaky and destabilizing, because she's being destabilized mentally, I think is the idea. It just feels a little too much to me. Personally, I would have directed it differently. This is brilliant. Craig Gillespie, who's the director of this.
I never thought that, but you're the expert.
Not.
This, it's subjective, it's my personal opinion.
Stella. Try as I might. I never was.
I'm not sweet as Stella tries, I might, I never was.
I'm Cruella. Born brilliant. Born bad. And a little bit mad.
I love the score.
I'm not like her. Better. Anyway. Mustache. Much to avenge, revenge, and destroy.
She's not British.
She is not British.
She's very not British.
You would never know. She grew up in friggin' Phoenix.
Well, and Brits get American accents right more than we get it right the other way around.
Number 17 cherry tree line, you say? All right. Come on with me.
A couple of insights. She says, I am not Estella. I'm not kind and sweet, and I never was.
Yeah.
She was, though. And she was for years. And it wasn't just her trying. It was her natural state. The way she treated Horace and Jasper, the love that she showed them, the connection that she had. What I think, though, is that she always felt weak and powerless.
Yeah.
As Estella. And as Cruella, she feels like she can thrive. And, you know, you say she's positioned to be a villain at the end of this film. Yes, but she's also not the Baroness. Because the Baroness is a murderer.
Yeah.
And Cruella is just cutthroat.
She's not pure evil, but she's certainly not good.
I think she lays hold on Cruella, on the Cruella persona, because that is where her power is.
Well, and that's what she's doing in this scene, right? She's burying Estella beneath, she's lying to herself.
She is.
But she's burying Estella so that she
in can, this version.
In this version, so that she can fully adopt the Cruella persona, even though she knows this isn't the full me. This
yeah.
is just, this is what I have to be to do the thing that I want to do.
And the full her is still coming through the cracks, which she says,
but I do love you. always.
The bit of performance there, it's not big, it's not flashy. It's a couple of breaths and then a relaxation in the face. And just Emma Stone is very good at this acting thing.
For her schemes to bring down the Baroness, she stays up all hours of the night to make these things happen in a short amount of time, to design all these dresses for all these people, to get all these invites out or to pull off these heists. And she's got this inflated self-esteem where she says, this grandiosity where she says, Cruella gets things done.
Stella does not.
And that is, look, self-esteem is great. Ego, not so great, but confidence is great. Mm-hmm. But she goes into this hypomanic place of, I can do anything. Mm-hmm. I'm not the Baroness, I'm better. And I'm not treating Horace and Jasper very well, and I know that, but I don't care because that person was weak.
Right.
That's grandiosity. And to be clear, hypomania doesn't always take that form. I know hypomanic people, and they're not jerks or supervillains. But in her case, that's how it's manifesting. Some of the things that we see that are conditions of hypomania, she's got an increase in goal-oriented activity. I mean, she was always pickpocketing and doing some designing on the side, but once she sets her sights on taking down the Baroness...
I love all of the Cruella stuff where she's upstaging the Baroness at her own events.
Yes.
Like, the future makeup on her face. Like, all of that stuff is just... It's so satisfying to watch. It's super fun.
She's got this twofold goal, which is I'm going to bring down the Baroness and destroy her, and then I'm going to be the best in the fashion world.
Yep.
And in order to achieve it, she needs this hypomanic energy.
Yeah.
Where she's recruiting people, where she's... I mean, the amount of... I love that the film doesn't shy away from how much work it takes to get revenge. To do what she's doing. In my opinion, it's good old-fashioned revenge and hatred.
Much to avenge, revenge, and destroy.
That's flavored with hypomania, but they're two separate things. This is just a short little overview of hypomania as we go explore Cruella, because there's more to see on her story.
And it goes...
Hello, Cruella.
Full telenovela.
I hate to ruin your party, but I've come to evict you.
Don't be absurd.
This is the key that was in the necklace that unlocks the box my birth certificate was in. Hello, Mother.
It's an Emma off, and I am here for it. Who is the most powerful Emma?
Where's Emma Watson?
Seriously.
You're so extraordinary.
You left me to die.
A mistake. And one we can get past. I know it.
Baroness full-blown narcissist will only apologize insincerely to serve a bigger goal, and it's usually manipulation.
The Baroness would like to invite you outside.
Me. Your real mother. Who made a mistake. And let something extraordinary go.
So early on, Cruella / Estella blamed herself for her mother's death. I should have stayed in the car. You know, the Dalmatians got loose because of me.
Well, to me, that feels like such a childlike understanding of, like, she blames herself for her mother's death because a kid doesn't understand that it's not my fault.
Yeah.
I am the center of my own world. If anything happens to people around me, it's my fault that that happened.
Well, and especially because subconsciously, the idea that it's somebody else's fault means that the people I'm with aren't safe.
Yeah.
And that's scary because if I'm a kid and it's my fault, then I can fix it and everyone around me is still safe. But if it's their fault, then holy
crap.
Then
the world isn't safe and
yeah,
anything can happen to me at any time.
She blames herself for her mom's death and then realizes that it was the Baroness all along.
Who's been messing up everything?
It's been the Baroness.
All along.
And that's where she starts to lose Estella because her self-guilt and self-loathing turns into hatred of another person.
Yeah.
And the fact that it's somebody that she admires, I mean, do you have you ever had a nemesis who was in your field and you just wanted to, like, knock them down a peg?
I haven't had that necessarily in my field. I have had professional jealousy where it feels like I want to knock a person down to prove what a great filmmaker I am. But I mean, that's never productive. I'm older and wiser now, and I try to not feel those things. It still sneaks in sometimes.
Well, and in real life, I mean, movies like these are great fun, and they can be empowering. The whole notion of stepping into your gifts and not being pushed around anymore and not taking any crap from anybody. And to a little bit of it, in an extent, I don't like the idea of stepping on people, but I do love the idea of making yourself known.
Yeah.
And stepping onto the scene in a big way. Like, I think more of us should do that because we have these gifts and talents.
For sure.
These revenge tales can be very satisfying because we're looking to experience something vicariously through the characters.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I love action movies and I abhor real life violence.
Yeah, no, you wouldn't want to be in Die Hard, but you love watching John McClane fight his way through a group of terrorists.
Because
you would never want to fight your way through a group of terrorists.
No, and I wouldn't actually want to kill anybody, even in self-defense. Like,
right,
I don't think
it would be gut-wrenching.
Yes, exactly, but on screen, it's cathartic.
So great.
It's a release, right?
Yeah.
Similarly, I think revenge tales serve a psychological purpose.
Yeah.
In that, in real life, revenge is unhealthy. In real life, revenge doesn't make you happy. In real life, revenge often leads to, as shown in this film, compromising your better nature for something else. We can watch this and still get like the vicarious experience of getting even with somebody and kind of how good that feels, and then we can let it go. I really enjoy this film. I really enjoy the performances. I would say watch movies with your brain turned on. There are times when the message of a film isn't great. Usually films, a lot of this trend of making the villain the protagonist of the story, that doesn't mean emulate this person, at least all across the board. And I watch this, now some people don't want to watch this with their kids because it's not heroic. I watch it with my kids and I have a conversation.
Mm-hmm. My six-year-old daughter watched this and she was like, she makes great clothes and she's real mean. And it was like, you nailed it, Audrey.
Now, as far as what I would do in therapy, if Cruella walked through my door, Cruella wouldn't walk through my door. She's damn happy with who she is.
She's thrilled.
She even says at the fountain that she's a little mad, and then she laughs like she's totally cool with that.
Mm.
It is very hard to do therapy with people who have problems and don't want to get help. But my biggest focus would be on the sense of betrayal. The sense of betrayal from her birth mother of wanting to give her up and let her die. She actually doesn't have a lot of betrayal towards her adopted mother, even though her adopted mother didn't tell her the truth, because she recognizes this person loved me and cared for me and wanted to bring out the best in me.
For sure.
My direction in therapy, as far as the hypomania would be concerned, would be to help Cruella recognize that Horace and Jasper have always been there for her and what she's sacrificing for her dreams to treat them the way that she's treating them.
Right.
That I have to believe that there is a way in almost any business to get ahead without basically selling your soul and losing the people that you care about. And so I would do a lot of relationship-based therapy. I'd do some grief counseling. The hypomania itself doesn't necessarily need treating. She needs to recognize it for what it is. So when it's happening and she's in a hypomanic state, it's like, okay, here's what I'm going to do so I don't go off the deep end. And here's how I'm going to make use of all of this really creative, productive, confident energy while I have it.
Sure.
Right? So that would be my two cents on how to work with her in therapy again.
She is not walking through your door willingly.
No, she's not.
If there's a court order.
So until next time.
You killed my mother.
You'll have to be more specific, darling.
And watch movies.